Dit inmiddels nummer 1486 met een uitzending voor vandaag 1 december 2018. Dit is het bulletin van zaterdag. Today's bulletin will be almost completely in English. Het bulletin van vandaag is grotendeels in het Engels. Aan het eind van de uitzending hebben we wel SSTV. SSTV met PD90. SSTV met PD90.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, November 30th. FT8 operators will be interested to know that a fifth candidate release, or beta version, of WSJT-X 2.0 software is available for download and use by beta testers. WSJT-X developer Joe Taylor, K1JT, says WSJT-X 2.0/RC5 is stable, works well, and fixes known problems in Release Candidate 4, the most recent beta version. On November 26th, Taylor said, quote, "It is likely that the general availability release of WSJT-X 2.0, scheduled for 2 weeks from today, will be nearly identical to RC5," unquote. The first dedicated FT8 contest, the FT8 Roundup, is set for the December 1st and 2nd weekend. In the brand new operating event, radio amateurs worldwide will contact and exchange information with other amateurs using FT8 on 80, 40, 20, 15, and 10 meters. Any station may work any other station. The exchange is signal report and state or province for U.S. and Canadian participants. Taylor also noted that the ARRL RIDI Roundup, January 5th and 6th, will, for the first time, permit the use of FT8 as well as traditional RIDI. Look for Taylor's article explaining the use of FT8 in the RIDI Roundup in the January issue of QST Magazine. On November 7th, the FCC Enforcement Bureau issued a Notice of Unlicensed Operation to technician licensee Daryl Thomas, KE6MWS, of Carmichael, California, for allegedly operating an unlicensed FM radio station. On October 10th, 2018, an Enforcement Bureau agent from the FCC's San Francisco office responded to a complaint of an unlicensed FM station operating on 95.7 MHz in Carmichael. The agent confirmed by direction-finding techniques that a signal on 95.7 MHz was emanating from a residence, and Thomas subsequently admitted that he was the operator of this station, the FCC said in the notice. The agent measured the field strength of the signal and found that it exceeded the maximum permitted level of 250 microvolts per meter at 3 meters, as established under FCC Part 15 rules. The FCC has rejected a petition for reconsideration that AMSAT filed 14 years ago, seeking to exempt amateur radio satellites from the FCC's satellite orbital debris mitigation requirements. The Commission took the opportunity in a Notice of Proposed Rulemaking and Order on Reconsideration, released on November 19th, that revisits its orbital debris rules for the first time since their adoption in 2004. Among other things, AMSAT had argued at the time of its petition that applying the orbital debris requirements to amateur radio satellites would be cost prohibitive, and that the FCC had not indicated what constitutes an acceptable orbital debris mitigation plan. Acknowledging that time has made some of AMSAT's arguments moot, the FCC said the costs involved with modification to comply with post-mission disposal requirements are justified when balanced against the public interest in mitigating orbital debris. The FCC said it determined that closer adherence to the disposal methods described in the rules was warranted in order to limit the growth of orbital debris in low Earth orbit. The FCC also said that in the years since the FCC issued its orbital debris order, numerous licensees, including amateur satellites operating in low Earth orbit, have successfully satisfied our orbital debris mitigation requirements. The Radio and TV Correspondents Association has honored Cox Media Group Senior Washington Correspondent Jamie Dupree, NS3T, with its 2018 Career Achievement Award for Distinguished Reporting on Congress. Dupree received the award during the RTCA annual dinner earlier this month, and the presentation was broadcast nationwide on C-SPAN 2. The Career Achievement Award for Distinguished Reporting on Congress honors a Capitol Hill broadcaster who represents career achievement and dedication to congressional coverage. Dupree's ability to speak was severely impaired in 2016 by a rare disorder, but a technological solution returned his voice to the airwaves. As the 54-year-old contester and Potomac Valley Radio Club member explained in a blog post last June, a Scottish company, Sarah Proc, sifted through years of Dupree's archived audio and built a voice for him, which he calls Jamie Dupree 2.0, that allows him to file radio reports again in a computer-generated voice. Dupree has been a radio broadcaster since 1983. Jack Tiley, AD7FO of Spokane Valley, Washington, has been appointed as the new ARRL Eastern Washington Section Manager starting on January 1, 2019. Tiley will fulfill the unexpired term of office that Mark Tharp, KB7HDX, will vacate following his election as Northwestern Division Vice Director.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
Finally, and we hope this is the final delay, Fox One Cliff is scheduled to launch on Sunday, December 2nd at 18, 31, and 47 seconds UTC. The rocket is also carrying FunCube on ESEO, JY1SAT, K2SAT, and XSEED-SAT. AMSAT is looking forward to the third of four Fox satellites reaching orbit soon so operational testing can begin. In case you missed it, FunCube 1 launched 5 years ago, celebrating its birthday on November 21st. Now more of the FunCube family is going into orbit. ESEO is FunCube 4, and JY1SAT is FunCube 6. FunCube is a design by volunteers in the UK and the Netherlands. Keep your eye on this launch. A lot will be going on after satellite deployment. Oscar numbers are rapidly approaching number 100. The latest Oscar number is LO94. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, November 30th. The sun is spotless, and the solar flux index has drifted down to about 68, but propagation remains pretty good on 160 through 40 meters. Even during a solar minimum, the lower bands remain in decent shape. For those of you who can operate on 160 meters, you'll reap the benefits during the ARRL 160 meter contest that's coming up this weekend. Now, next weekend, December 8th and 9th, is the ARRL 10 meter contest. The long range forecast isn't promising for this event, as you would imagine, but don't forget that 10 meters can produce surprises, as with all the so-called dead bands. 10 meters has a tendency to open during contests. Funny how that works. On VHF and UHF, this is the beginning of the winter sporadic E season. We've received a few reports already from FT8 operators that 6 meters has been popping open, particularly in the late morning and early afternoon.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. The other day, one of my non-amateur friends asked for some help. He wants to set up a receiver for his bushfire brigade that's available via the internet, so his community can listen to the communication channels when there are fires around, or when a volunteer is out of radio range but still wants to hear what's going on. His question was about hooking up an antenna. We started to discuss what he already had, and it turns out that he has enough coaxial cable in either 50 ohm RG58 or alternatively 75 ohm low-loss quad-shielded satellite TV coax. He's not an amateur, won't be broadcasting, and just needs it to work without spending too much money. We then started talking about antennas, and he had a tuned whip and a generic scanner antenna. Turns out that the tuned whip was for 78 MHz and he needs to listen on 164 MHz. So I suggested the scanner antenna, so-called broadband, but no actual specifications. Then we talked about how it was going to be mounted to his metal roof. Tech screws to the iron, a CB mount with solder pads. That started a conversation about waterproofing and coax rot, termination, and then the ground plane. I could get my antenna analyzer out, drive to his place an hour or so away, help him install and test it, and then decide that we need other options. We might still decide to do that, but it will be driven by what happens at his installation. If you're a licensed amateur with a little experience, this story will leave you with a whole lot of but. If you're not, then you've come away with, "That's pretty reasonable, let's go." What I find fascinating is the gap between those two. On the one hand, you've got knowledge that says this isn't ideal. Who in their right mind would hook up a random antenna without the proper ground plane with an unknown feed point impedance to a 75 ohm coax using solder pads on the top of a roof? There's more, of course, but those are the big ticket items. On the other hand, you have an antenna, coax, connectors that fit, and a high likelihood of noise coming from your radio. I'm not going to pretend that the choices we made over the phone are the final ones, or that it will even work as described. But we discussed that, and the selection of parts gives us the highest chance of success. And rather than give the right answer, we went with the closest we could get without spending a cent. The gap between knowing and not knowing can be perilous, but it can also be used as a map to navigate from one to the other. Is this going to work? Who knows? Too many variables to be certain, too many unknowns. Sometimes ignorance is bliss, and sometimes knowledge is a burden. Finding the balance is a lifetime of learning. I'm Onno, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima, Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
Microfoon naar retour.